Welcome. So today we're going to talk about Bayesian analysis and how prior information that we can learn about a situation we can use to update our analysis as we learn more and more. It actually helps us in many, many ways to be able to get to a confidence of our understanding of the data much, much faster. So let's kind of look at kind of the benefits of Bayes before we really dive into some of the computation. So first off, as we were just talking about, it does consider prior information or data so that we can reduce our probability space. What does that mean? That means, let's say we're tackling a brand new problem, you know, like how effectively we're approaching a market space, let's say in Africa, of this new technology development, some telecom that we're doing, and we're not really sure the customer space. We have some ideas, but we only have vague data. So what we may be able to do is take information that we can glean and then use that so that instead of saying, you know what, we really have no clue, it's really a 50-50 shot whether we think this is going to work, to, well, we've actually had some interviews with some folks, we have some ideas of this over here, so now we're going from maybe a 50-50 chance to, you know what, maybe we're maybe 70% confident that this might work into the space. And then do some data analyses that uses that as our fundamental assumption as we further do our analyses and maybe some probability analysis. It definitely is part of probability analysis, but this allows us to ultimately get to higher and higher confidence. Usually people, before they want to really pull the trigger, they want to have something close to a 90% confidence. You don't always get that. However, that's actually a good bar for having some confidence in an activity that you're going to invest money and time and work into before really pulling all those triggers. We also can use it sequentially in experimental design. So we can do an experiment and run it over and over again, and there's actually some good data of how this reduces uncertainty as we continue measurements. In fact, there's a great example that I have linked here from NIST, National Institute of Standards, and they actually have a program that anybody can use, it's free to researchers, with Python code. So if you're really into Python and you want to be able to run some automated, iterative Bayesian approaches, this is the place to go. You can contact the researchers there. They have code that's readily available in Python that's been vetted, they've been using it, and then maybe get some help and guidance on how to use this in an automated way. And this is where it becomes powerful. So they even showed where they were using it in some quantum tuning, and they were also using it in some resonance measurements, which is also at the link, to show that they got a 10x reduction in the amount of number of samples that they needed to get to some confidence a bit about the behavior of their system. So that's fantastic, because if you just do classical stats, sometimes that's all you can get is that much higher rate, where this is, by doing things iteratively, you can actually contract the number of data points that you actually need to get to optimization. So for some of you in the class, maybe that's something that you want to do as your project. You can actually use this type of technique. Others, maybe that's not something you're comfortable with. But I wanted to put that out there so that you realize there is some freeware that you can use. And it also can help you determine the value of the measurement that you're taking. So let's kind of step back. Let's do an introduction again of Bayes' theorem and the rule as it starts. So when we talk about probabilities, you know, back to stats. We think of probabilities of, you know, flipping coins or picking a yellow bead out of a yellow and green bag of beads, those types of things. So this is kind of what we're talking about again, but we're applying it to much broader questions across any type of data. And it doesn't matter if this is human data, physical data, you name it. So that it's not a limiter in that case. It also requires us to put in our intelligence back into the system. You notice a lot of the different types of data analyses we've done previously, there's really not a lot of wisdom being incorporated into the data measuring. Not at all. Bayes, and the whole kind of point of Bayes, was that as we learn things and we incorporate knowledge, we get better at stuff. We get better at approximating. We get better at estimating. And in so doing that, we should be able to have a way to mathematically incorporate that into our models, into our analyses. And so that's precisely what this is really designed to do. So from a mathematical standpoint, when we talk about probabilities, we usually talk about, you know, two things, two possibilities of occurrence. There's an event A or an occurrence. Now this could be an occurrence of something. It could be the state of a particle. It could be something that we're testing because we're not quite sure whether it's going to happen or not. Say maybe it's, you know, did we successfully vaccinate somebody where they're not getting the disease, right? So A could be any of those things. B is also an event or an observation. Now I'm just kind of trying to use different language for each of them, but they're really different exclusive events that can have crossover properties, right? Where one may or may not have an effect of another. Now note that I put in here was we're not assuming causality. Be careful on that because it's an easy rabbit hole to go down where you're assuming because B happened, then A is going to happen. That's not necessarily what we're saying here. What we're saying here is, for example, P of A of B means that what's the probability that A occurs or happens in light of that B has happened or is occurring. So that's what PA to B is, the probability that it's the and statement between those two. Otherwise, P of A is just the probability that A happens. P of B is the probability that B happens. And then the vice versa, the probability that B occurs due to A happening, it sounds like it's just the opposite, but the probabilities are not necessarily equal. And that's what this statement tells us, that it's not P of A to B is equal to P of B to A. That's not the case. They're actually multiplied by their probabilities. And this is what the rule of the law of Bayes' theorem shows us. Now, the other thing that we have to note before we can actually get to using Bayes' theorem in a useful way in a lot of different applications is trying to look at probability B. Let me go back. So probability of B happening is what's on the denominator of this equation. Well, that's not always available. However, writing a probability of anything, whether it's a B or a C or, you know, whatever it is really the sum, the weighted sum of its conditional probabilities. And that's what this statement tells us. And so this is an extension rule. So the probability of event B when A happens times the probability of A, notice it's always multiplying by the right-hand side of that piece, plus the probability of B occurring or happening when A does not happen. That's what those little half-shelf looking things are. That's a not statement. Times the probability that A does not happen. So if you notice, and so if you were to actually sum up the probability that A happens and the probability of A not happening, let's say the probability of A happening is 60%. That means then the probability of A not happening is, you probably guessed it, 40%. That's knowable. Once we know one, we know the other. And then oftentimes we can actually infer or figure out what's happening with the probability of B happening with not A. And it also puts to where if we already know the probability of B happening when A happens, it's actually in the numerator and the denominator now. So it's something that we can reuse. Okay. So what? Right? Got a great little equation. Yippee. What do we do with it, right? It all comes down to application. So let's show in a little example of what we're talking about here. This will give you a little bit better idea of how to process this information. So let's say we want to understand the probability of having a disease versus being tested for a disease. So in here we say, what's your probability of having a disease with a positive test, knowing that our test accuracy is 95%. We also then have data that supports that we have a 0.5% false positive rate. What does that mean? That means somebody tests positive, but then we verified through other tests that they aren't really positive, right? So usually it requires, to be able to get this information, there has to be studies done to really understand that that's a situation. And then we also have to understand the overall disease prevalence. So in this case, we're saying about 1 in 10,000 people have this particular disease. Fair enough. So this is the information that we know through some studies. So first off, let's get our variables straight. So A is going to be this person has a disease. Great. B means we have had a positive test. So these are the events that we're classifying. We're putting our categories here of what A means and what B means. That's monumental to be able to asking the right questions. So what we really want to know is what's our probability of having the disease with a positive test, which would be P of A, knowing that B has occurred, right? So we go back to that. So now we can put it in terms of disease and positive test, because sometimes that's easier. Instead of trying to translate it to variables, we keep it in the context of the conversation we're having. So we're saying the probability of having the disease, or we're just calling it D, in light of that we had a positive test. So we're just calling it pos test. This is what we want to know. Now, the other things that we do know from the data that we have here in this example is the probability of a positive test occurring and the disease already present in the person is 95%. That is our test accuracy. So that's where we know that if we have this test and we run, it picks up 95% of the cases of people that actually have the disease. So if we tested it in 100 people that we knew had the disease, again, that we knew had the disease, that means we would get 95 positive results out of those 100. So absorb that. So that's really what we mean by test accuracy. Now, we also have the probability that we get a positive test, but somebody does not have the disease, right? Well, if we know that it's 95% where we get a positive test and they do, what's interesting here is a false positive tells us they have a positive test, but they don't have the disease. And so that is 0.005% or 0.5% false positive. Notice it's not 5%. It is not the opposite of the test accuracy. It's not like 1 minus 95%. That's a common mistake. Don't make that mistake. This is a different measure altogether. So this is where they could have taken data with a whole bunch of people that they knew did not have a disease. They tested them and 0.5% showed a positive test, even though they knew they did not have the disease. Okay, it's a different type of population. Okay, and then the last piece, probability of disease, is really the prevalency. So it's 1 divided by, oh, now there it says 10,000. Here I've got 100,000. I got to fix that. That's supposed to be 10,000. So I'll fix that after this presentation. But yeah, it should be 1 over 10,000. Because that's what I have on all the calculations. Okay, so now that we have these, let's try to plug in what we have and where we can plug it in. So ultimately, we're trying to figure out a P of the disease with a positive test. So if we're using our Bayesian outcome, we have P of the positive test with those with the disease times the prevalence of the disease times the probability of a positive test overall, right? And so that's where we break it down. That's where we use that second formula. We can break that down to the sum of both when the disease occurs and when the disease does not occur. So that's all we've done here. It's the same exact thing, except we've instead of A's and B's, we've plugged in positive tests and D's. So now we plug in the numbers. So we know, and this is why writing out your variables is so critical, so that you make sure that you know what you know and what you don't know, what you have to find out. So we know our positive test with disease, which is actually our test accuracy, is 95%. Great. That's multiplied by the probability of the disease, 1 over 10,000. So that's our numerator. Our denominator, a little more complicated. It's the same thing as the numerator. This is why it helps to redefine that bottom into the sum of the probabilities, weighted sum of the probabilities. So it's 95% times the probability of the disease again. So it's exactly the numerator. So that first term is exactly the same thing as the numerator. However, where it changes is here, is the probability of that positive test when the disease is not prevalent, that's that 0.5%, so we put 0.005 times the probability that disease is not happening. Now this one's easy because we already know the probability of the disease occurrence is 1 in 10,000. So it's really all the rest of those people, 9,999 people out of that 10,000 do not have that disease. That's our probability, right? So logically it makes sense once you kind of think it through. We do all that in our little algebra calculation and we get a prevalence of 1.86%. So think about that for just a second. Does that make sense? Now, it may not be intuitive, and usually for most people, this is not intuitive. Why? Because you just told us that we have a test accuracy of 95%. I would think intuitively that because I have a test accuracy of 95%, that if I have a test, that means I would interpret intuitively that I have a 95% chance likelihood that I actually have the disease. That is not true. That blows people away sometimes. Like, that doesn't make any sense to me at all. Well, that's how it turns out in this particular example. So have you ever thought about why we may have more than one test for something, or why doctors, when they give you one test, they will follow it up with another test or maybe two tests? The reason is one test doesn't necessarily give you complete confirmation. It gives you one data point of confirmation. But if you have a previous positive test and then you do another test, that changes your probability of knowing that that test is in fact true. So bear with me. That kind of blows some people away. Now, we can do things hand calculated like that. That takes quite a while. In class, what we're going to do is we're going to use a spreadsheet. And what's nice about this, and this was derived from some materials from How to Measure Anything. And so then we reformatted, recalculated, and we actually modified some things. But what we can do is we have some probability of in this case, like have disease and positive test, and we can show, so the calculations are being done in the background. So notice we have the probability of having disease. Now this one's different. This is 0.01% probability of not having disease. This actually needs to be modified because it's not showing the correct fraction here. It's actually underneath the hood, but it's just only showing to the nearest whole number, which is part of the problem with that one. So we need to modify that on the spreadsheet itself. We also have the probability of a positive test and having disease. So this is where the test accuracy is plugged in. We also have the probability of a positive test but not having the disease. And that was 0.5%. So these yellow boxes here on the spreadsheet are our inputs. And this is the data that we know. Now, it automatically calculates the other probabilities that we have as well. Then what we were solving for is down here in green. So this gets solved for automatically once we have it in. And that tells us the probability of having the disease and a positive test of 1.86%. And that's the output that we get. And then we can play around with all of these other types of probabilities, such as probability of having disease, but not a positive test, or probability of not having disease and no positive test, or not having disease and a positive test. So all these things are possible in the spreadsheet itself. And so in the class, we're going to be going through and using this to do some analyses. So the question becomes then, okay, how is that useful to me? It just makes me very skeptical about my test. Well, that's not the point. The point is that when you iterate and you do something again and again, you get more and more confidence about what actually is happening, even if there is some error. And that's why we do repeated measures, because we get more information, and so our probabilities change. So if we give the results of the first test, we had a 1.86% chance that we think we actually have the disease because we got a positive test. Now, again, this is very specific because of the case we're talking about. It's the person who actually took the test, right? Because we're trying to test the disease. It doesn't mean it's for everybody in general. So it's very specific. So why would you get a second test? If you think about when they do the COVID testing, why do they sell the test in packets of two? It's usually so that if you have a positive test, it's usually not just to kind of save it for later. It's so that you have a second test so you can get a higher prevalence of confidence that you actually, in fact, do have the disease. Because you could get one that gives you a positive and then a negative. And now you're kind of back to square one. Or you could get one that's a negative and a false positive. But if you have two positives in a row, that gives you much more confidence that actually it's true. Or if you get two negatives in a row. So what I want the students to do then in this class is actually use this spreadsheet in the class, recalculate the D of positive test. However, plug in your result to update the prior prevalence. So remember before we said the prevalence was 1 in 10,000. But for you specifically, we can now say, because of our previous test, it's like, well, because I had a previous positive test, I'm going to say my prevalence is 1.86%, not 1 in 10,000. You follow? So if I plug in the 1.86%, or it's rough, let's say it's 2%, right? So now the prevalence goes up, and that changes the entire calculation. So I don't want to give away all the answers, but I want you to actually go through this exercise with the spreadsheet so that you can then check out and see what happens. So what is your probability of having the disease with a second positive test? So again, you're plugging in for the 1 in 10,000, which was population general, with the 1.86% just for you, or 0.0186. You'll plug that in instead of the 1 in 10,000. Everywhere there was a 1 in 10,000, you use this number instead. You'll get a different value. What is the probability of having the disease with a negative test? And this is where you can use some of those other answers. What is your probability of not having the disease with a second positive test? And so that's really what you want to get at. What does that second test give you? It's like having a second opinion, right? But actually from a test standpoint. And what is your probability of not having the disease with a negative test? So again, I'm not going to give away the answers to these here because this is the exercise I want you guys going through when we're in class. All right. So another type of example, we can do this for other types of things. We could do it for market testing where we have high uncertainty and we're not sure. So let's say we're testing a new product and we want to be able to make profit in the first year with this new product. Great goal. Wonderful. So we've got some previous data. Well, what do we know? We've experienced and our previous experience and data suggests that we have about a 50% chance of a product making profit the first year. Same as flipping a coin, right? In other words, we don't really know, but it's about a 50-50 shot that in that first year, we're going to make a profit. So we're going to call this the probability that we're going to have PFY, or profit first year. So we'll run a test market pilot before we do full-scale production. Always a smart thing to do so you don't fully invest and launch without knowing a little more information. This is, in fact, why they do market test piloting, so they can get more information and be more confident. So it says, historically, our products that were successful, and in this case, we've defined success as profit in the first year, in the test market, and went on to be profitable the first year, is 80%. So now, successful also means that it was successful later. So that also means that we probably had products that were successful but also didn't make a profit in the first year, and that's probably about a 20%. So this one gives us 80%. So the other variable is going to be S. So that's our B, right? So our A is PFY, our S is RB in this case. So the probability of success in the first year profit, being that they had a first year profit, is 80%. Now there's lots of other ways to define success. It doesn't have to be that way. We can define it as break-even sales threshold that we passed that, so we're actually making profits. Maybe it's some dollar amount sales or dollar amount profit, number of units sold within a 3-month period. You know, success is really defined on an individual basis how the company wants to define success. And there's a lot of varieties of that. So in this case, they also did something else. They brought a calibrated expert, so basically somebody who really knows the industry really well, suggests that a 30% probability of a successful test market outcome and not be profitable in the first year. So, you know, it could be that they may assume that it's 20%, but this is a calibrated expert. It says, you know, that's not always the case. So it's really more likely to be about 30%. So this is a little different. So, and this is where that other play comes in. So the probability of success, but it was not profitable the first year. In reality, by wisdom, you know, experience in the market is assuming roughly 30%, not the 20%. So what we want to know is, what is the first year profit, or are we going to make first year profit based upon a successful market test? Okay. So same kind of equation, right? But now we have PFY as our A, S as our B. Same exact equation. It's just, we're just filling out everything so it's explicit. And then we have numbers for all of these. We have 80% chance of success with first year profit times a 50-50 chance of success. Or 50-50 chance of first year profit. Same thing in the first term here. These, remember, these, this first term and these and the numerator are always going to be the same if you do this right. And then we have the 30%. That's that magic factor. Not really magic, but if you have a calibrated expert, and we talk about that in another class, what that is, particularly with industry experience, they have a better sense of what's going on because they have experience and wisdom of the space. And then, of course, the not successful is 1 minus 50%. Notice I didn't put 0.5 here because I didn't want you to confuse the probability of not being profitable in the first year as known 50%. It's 1 minus whatever this is. So I wanted to be explicit on that. So this tells us, really, our probability that we're going to have profit in the first year and a successful test market is 72.7%. So, again, you can use the same spreadsheet that we were using for the last example, and then answer these other questions. What is the probability that the product is profitable in the event of an unsuccessful market test? And what is the probability the product is not profitable in the event of a successful market test? So the beauty about the Bayes approach in this sense is that you can answer lots of different questions and glean more and more information. And then the more testing you do, the better and better your confidence gets. You will be able to improve. So this kind of shows what it looks like in the spreadsheet. We have a 50-50 shot of profitability, 80% success rate with the first year profit, and then a 30% success rate when we're not profitable in the first year. And notice those are not exactly the same. Because the knots and strategic or specifically mathematically speaking, this is not the opposite of that. What is the opposite of this, and notice how it's worded here, is the probability of not being successful with the first year profit. That's the 20%. So it's actually S and not S. This is where you get one minus the other. Here we have S not profitable. That's different. And then for here to here, so it's like four quadrants, we have not S and not profitable. And that's going to be these two add to 100%. So notice not PFY, not PFY, but here's S not S. So it's based upon this left-hand side of when we're going to have something that adds to 100%, 80%, 20%, 30%, 70%, based upon A, not A. And that's a little confusing, but you want to keep that in mind. And then, of course, the initial answer we were looking for was the 72.3%. And then the answers to some of those other questions are here in these other areas. All right. Here's some of the references for reading. Again, I put some of these in the syllabus as well. If you want a little bit more on the proof of Bayes' theorem, or you want to understand it geometrically, so maybe if some of you are more visual learners and you like to understand it more geometrically, these are some great videos by 3Blue1Brown that they have. And then also, if you're just totally confounded by the medical space and that medical test paradox, this is a great video on the medical test paradox as well. So I encourage you to look those through and get involved with that kind of stuff. So great. And I will see you in class. We'll get to run some exercises and have a lot of fun with this. All right. Hope you had a great day. Thank you.